Private members' business, resuming debate at second reading of Bill C-586, the Reform Act 2014, standing in the name of Mr. Chong.
Resuming debate, the Honourable Member for Scarborough Agincourt.
Mr. Speaker, I rise for the first time in this House to join the debates, and I do so with a profound sense of humility. I also wish to express my tremendous appreciation to the residents of Scarborough Agincourt for the distinct honour of representing them as their Member of Parliament. As this is my inaugural address in the House of Commons, I am mindful of the sense of history of this place. In my youth, I fell in love with Canadian history. And when I finally had the opportunity to visit Parliament, I realized why this place is so important. Not only is this where we make our laws and establish our government, it is this place that symbolizes a fundamental value, our democratic freedom. This is a freedom that flows through our evolved relationship with the Crown and with the institutions of sovereign and colonial power. Mr. Speaker, I have deliberately chosen this piece of legislation to rise for my first time to join the debates in the House of Commons because I recognize the very important symbolism that this bill has come to represent across this country. There is a very fundamental sense that democracy in our country, and frankly, across all democratic countries, is gradually eroding. Participation rates in elections have been steadily dropping. Canadians are increasingly developing a sense that our democratic institutions do not matter. As members of Parliament, we each owe a critical duty to arrest this development and to increase confidence in our democratic institutions. I look to my recent by-election and that of my fellow three colleagues that were elected on June 30th. And in that by-election, we saw participation rates drop to incredible lows. Sadly, in my riding of Scarborough Agincourt, less than 30% of electors chose to cast a ballot. In my colleague from Trinity Spadina, he probably had the best result in having approximately one-third of the ballots cast of those who were eligible to vote. In the two Alberta by-elections, we saw voter participation drop to roughly 19% in McLeod and 15% in Fort McMurray Athabasca. We have seen participation rates in successive federal and provincial elections continue to drop. I think this is a broad question that all of us as members need to ask and ultimately to be concerned about. To that end, Mr. Speaker, I want to pay tribute to the Honourable Member for Wellington, Halton Hills, for the intent behind his private member's bill, Bill C-586, entitled simply the Reform Act. In reading his backgrounder on this bill, I noted that it was his intent to reinforce the principle of responsible government. It was also his intent to provide checks against the exercise of executive power over the legislature. In particular, my friend sought to ensure that party leaders maintain the confidence of their respective caucuses. This is a laudable goal, and it is an attempt to bring back the normative practices of our Westminster model of government. But when one actually examines the substance of the bill, Mr. Speaker, I have to admit that I find somewhat a disconnect between the very aspirational aspects that the member for Wellington, Halton Hills, is proposing and the practical outcomes of his bill. It leads to a series of questions and concerns. In his backgrounder to the legislation, my friend from Wellington, Halton Hills, attempts to address four broad reforms. One, restoring local control over party nominations. Two, strengthening caucus as a decision-making body. Three, reinforcing accountability of the party leader to caucus. And four, reforming the institution of Parliament. Mr. Speaker, I submit to you that my friend's intent to codify what has been the conventional practices reflects, unfortunately, a failing of members to exercise the very rights and privileges as members of Parliament. In some aspects, the changes proposed are rigid in that it seeks to impose and create controls over political parties and their practices. I have trouble with this approach. I can fully understand having parliamentary oversight over the practices of political parties, for example, as it relates to issues like financing, particularly when there are implications on our tax systems, or there might be the possibility of undue influence as a result of public financing. But as it relates to the organization of political parties themselves, I am fundamentally convinced that these organizations should set their own rules and that participation by the broader public will be judged on the effect of how democratically that these institutions operate. Let's leave the constitution of political parties up to the political parties themselves. I know that the Honourable Member for Wellington Halton Hills has consulted broadly on his bill, including soliciting input from various members of this House to address the operational concerns of his proposed legislation. I applaud my friend for reaching out. This is, in fact, how we should be working together and to return ourselves to a more civil time when all members in this place were treated with honour and respect. Let me say that here in the Liberal Party, we intend to honour the very spirit of my friend's legislation. It is our intent on this side of this House to allow all members of the Liberal Caucus to vote on this private member's bill by way of a free vote. Let me also say that despite outlining some of our concerns, it is my intention to support my friend's bill and to vote yes when it comes up for a vote in second reading. I will note that I reserve my right to reconsider my vote depending on what transpires when this bill is sent to committee and we see what emerges in third reading. I should also state that the Liberal Party has a different approach. I recognize that my friend from Wellington Halton Hills may have some cause for concern over the practices within his own party or by the approach taken by the Prime Minister and the Executive Council. But here in the Liberal Party, we've decided that restoring trust in Canada's democracy will encompass the following reforms that have been passed by a priority resolution by our own party. And these include free and open democratic nomination of our candidates, fewer whipped votes and more freer votes, requiring individual MPs to assume full responsibility of their decisions, stronger parliamentary control of public finances, including an annual deadline for the budget, accounting consistency among estimates and public accounts, more clarity in voting on estimates, a cost analysis of all government bills, and a requirement that government borrowing plans must obtain Parliament's pre-approval. We will seek an independent and properly resourced parliamentary budget officer. We will move to a more effective access to information system with safeguards against political interference and meaningful whistleblower protections. An impartial system to identify and eliminate wasteful partisan government advertising like we actually have in the Government of Ontario. Limitations on secret committee proceedings, limiting omnibus bills, and the use of prorogation for short-term convenience of the government. We will move to adequate funding, investigative powers, and enforcement authority to ensure that Elections Canada can root out electoral fraud. We will move for proactive disclosure of parliamentarians' expenses and a more transparent Board of Internal Economy that has proper audit rules. And finally, we will move towards a truly independent Senate. To that end, I would encourage my friend to also support Bill C-613, known as the Transparency Act, that was introduced by my leader, the Honourable Member for Papineau. Mr. Speaker, the goals of this bill that my friend from Wellington Halton Hills is presenting are laudable. Those on this side want a House where Parliament respects the principles of responsible government and the rule of law. I know my friend has had challenges within his own party, and that with the sometimes difficult nature of the exercise of executive power. Therefore, I challenge my friend from Wellington Halton Hills. Make the changes within your own party before we impose changes on all political parties. And if you can't change your party, you're welcome to change parties. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Resuming debate, the Honourable Minister of State for Democratic Reform.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. thank you for occasion to rise on this bill titled the Reform Act, and I'd like to thank the member for Wellington Halton Hills for presenting with us with the occasion to debate that very subject before this chamber. This debate allows us to highlight the important improvements that we have witnessed under this Prime Minister and this government in the area of democratic reform. Now, I understand that in politics, one of the idiosyncrasies with which we must be faced is that sometimes narratives depart long way from the facts. And people have a tendency to confuse, for example, strength with centralization, competence with control. And so it is when many critics in the public sphere judge the degree of central power in the various parties that are in the House today. I think we should examine the facts to see how the parties actually add up on this very question. And let me examine some of those empirical facts. The Globe and Mail published an analysis of 162,000 votes cast on the floor of this House of Commons by individual MPs. And it found that during a two-year period between June 2nd, 2011 and January 28, 2013, the Liberal Party voted as a unanimous bloc 90% of the time, with no difference of opinion whatsoever. The Conservative Party had independent votes, that is, members of the caucus voted differently than the leadership, in 1 in 4 votes on the floor of the House of Commons. The NDP whipped 100% of its MPs 100% of the time. That is to say, in that two-year period, there was literally not one MP who dared disagree with their leader even once, which is an exceptional statement of the centralization of powers that have occurred in the NDP. We move to the subject of the Senate. Now, I think all of us are frustrated with the outcome of the Supreme Court ruling on that question. But I think it's important to note what was at stake, because it's actually the reference to the Supreme Court on the question of the Senate was actually very ironic. I'm not aware of another occasion in our history where a Prime Minister has gone to court to ask judges to take powers away from him. He actually went to the court and asked the court to allow him to give the people the authority over who would represent them in the Senate. He agreed that if provinces held elections, that he would respect the outcome and that he would oblige himself to do so in federal statutory law. Equally ironic was that it was the courts that actually refused to let him give away the powers he wanted to cede. But no less, it is interesting to note that he wanted to cede them in the first place, an action and a motive that is not normally part of the constitution of any leader of government. But with this Prime Minister, it is, as I will further elaborate when I come to our position on this particular bill. On the question of private members' bills in general, I should note that under this Parliament, with a majority Conservative government and this Prime Minister, we actually have more private members' bills passed into law than at any time since 1972. And that Parliament, in that Parliament, many of the bills were just name changes to constituencies. So in terms of legislating, this Parliament, under a majority Conservative government led by this Prime Minister, has had more backbenchers enact legislation than at any time in history. Now, some have become cynical about this fact and said, oh, well, you know, it's just the government is actually putting private members up to passing legislation. They offer no proof of that, except that the government actually voted for the legislation. So there's your catch-22. If the government had actually voted against this backbench legislation, you would say that the government was blocking it. But having voted for it, now you say, well, it can't be that independent if the government actually supported it at the end of the day. We will see that with these critics, there's no winning. But Canadians are winning because of the democratic action of members of this House. The member for Manitoba, who was able to introduce legislation to protect young, vulnerable people from human trafficking. The member for Okanagan-Coquihalla was able to actually amend legislation from the Prohibition era that prevented Canadians from transporting wines across and other spirits across borders, and now allows Canadians to actually drink Canadian-produced wines and beers. We also had the member for Kitchener-Conestoga, who succeeded in passing suicide prevention legislation through this House of Commons, serious, substantive legislation passed by backbench MPs under this government. Now, we have another bill before this House of Commons, the Reform Act. Now, that bill would, for example, address the 45-year-old requirement in law that a leader sign off on the candidacy of every single person who is on the ballot for the party. So, in law, since 1970, it has been a requirement that a party leader sign off on every candidate. Without that signature, you cannot be a candidate. Now, even parties that would prefer to have another form of approval for their candidates cannot do so because the statutory law in Section 67(4)(c) bans them from doing it. When my friend in the Liberal Party, who I congratulate on delivering his maiden speech, says that these matters should not be codified in law, I point out the fact that they already are, in this instance, codified in law. The statute forces parties to give leaders veto power over their candidates, even if the party constitution disagrees. So the treasured party autonomy, in which he is in pursuit, does not exist in the current law. The member for Wellington, Halton Hills seeks to change that by removing this veto power from the leaders and allowing parties to select any officer or officers they think fit to approve their candidacies. Now, the Liberal Party, I suspect, would oppose that. The leader of their party has abused that power in order to prevent numerous people from running for the Liberal Party. To just today, 6 former MPs for the Liberal Party actually spoke out against their leader and said that he was abusing his veto power to impose his ideology on every single candidate that runs for the Liberals. He has further made had preferences for friends that he wanted to have on the ballot for his party, and he has basically used the legal authority embedded in the Elections Act to give to hand nominations to those friends at the expense of other people who would probably have more merit and be able to win the nominations if it were democratically held. In our party, that decision is left to local party members, the grassroots. And in practice, our leader has not used his whip, his legal power in an abusive manner. Furthermore, and this is another instance where this Prime Minister is now acting in a manner that is more democratic than any of his predecessors. He becomes the first leader in a half century to declare his support for the removal of the legal veto power of party leaders over candidates. That speaks once again to his willingness to cede power to the Canadian people and to grassroots political participants so that they can exercise their own will. And I think that gesture on behalf of our Prime Minister demonstrates that he is ahead of his predecessors on the question of democratic reform and certainly ahead of his competitors in this House of Commons. The member who brings forward this legislation has congratulated the Prime Minister for creating the space in which this kind of debate can occur. And the member is absolutely right. There is no other party, no other caucus, under no other leader would this kind of debate ever have been permitted. Because only on this side of the House and under this Prime Minister can we openly discuss the nature of our democracy and propose substantive reforms to improve it. So for that, I thank our Prime Minister, and I look forward to continuing this debate. Thank you.
Reprise du débat, l'honorable député de Louis-Saint-Laurent.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Président. Je suis très contente d'avoir l'occasion de parler du projet de loi C-586 aujourd'hui pour pouvoir parler de la teneur exacte de ce projet de loi surnommé le Reform Act. Le NPD parle depuis très longtemps du déficit démocratique qui existe au Canada. De quoi s'agit-il? L'expression « déficit démocratique » réunit deux grandes catégories de concepts. Une bien réelle, se rapportant à l'exercice même de la démocratie, et une autre plus abstraite, qui touche à la perception qu'a l'électorat de ce même exercice. La démocratie canadienne est forte d'une expérience vieille de 150 ans. Elle est bien établie, fiable, et en quelque sorte, elle est un sine qua non. Nous ne pourrions plus envisager nos vies dans ce pays sans elle. Même si on la critique, et parfois avec raison, au fond, elle nous sert bien. À travers les années, on a amélioré le procédé démocratique quand on sentait qu'une anomalie s'y était glissée. Au gré des défis, avec les mœurs qui changeaient, avec les bouleversements démographiques, les sensibilités régionales, tranquillement, on a modelé et modifié cette Chambre à l'image du Grand Canada et de ses gens. Ce que j'essaie de dire, c'est que lorsque des problèmes de nature concrète se présentent, on les règle. L'exception majeure, et on va le dénoncer encore longtemps, c'est la soi-disant déforme électorale du printemps dernier qui va bloquer en grande partie la fluidité dans les scrutins à venir. Alors que nous sommes témoins d'une usure alarmante de la ferveur démocratique et que des gestes éclairés et dynamiques devraient être posés pour réveiller et intéresser l'électorat, une loi électorale répressive inspirée par celle de l'Allemagne de l'Est a reçu l'aval enthousiaste du gouvernement conservateur. Le déficit démocratique dont je parle est provoqué par des circonstances socioculturelles évidentes. Habitués à la démocratie, une partie grandissante du public ne sent plus sa fragilité et oublie sa responsabilité de citoyen électeur. C'est un phénomène très inquiétant auquel le NPD cherche des solutions depuis longtemps. Le gouvernement, lui, se réjouit quand le marasme règne. C'est triste, mais c'est comme ça. Sauf que notre plateforme à nous est claire et solide. Nous, on va tout mettre en œuvre pour combattre ce marasme. C'est à quoi s'attendent les Canadiens et on ne les laissera pas tomber. Le déficit est causé par des pratiques réelles dont il faut sans cesse réajuster les rouages pour en assurer l'efficacité et une perception générale qui attribue faussement, selon moi, à notre démocratie un caractère opaque et élitiste. Le projet de loi C-586 n'est pas la grande réforme qu'il prétend être pour cette raison toute simple. Alors qu'il dit s'attaquer à un problème concret, en fait, il agit d'abord et avant tout sur un problème de perception. Un projet de loi, c'est une solution proposée à un problème. Si C-586 sert à resserrer un boulon d'un des mécanismes concrets de notre démocratie, quel est ce problème? Si la solution est 42, est-ce qu'on sait c'est quoi la question? Voici le problème que ce projet de loi voudrait régler. Les chefs de parti et les preneurs de décisions dans les partis ont trop de pouvoir sur les procédés de domination et sur les décisions en chambre lors des votes. L'application de ces pouvoirs diluerait la voix démocratique du citoyen et contribuerait à l'opacité du régime qui nous dirige. Pour remédier à cela, et c'est ce que propose C-586, les associations de circonscription, le domaine de ce qui en anglais on nomme le grassroots, la base partisane, doit pouvoir choisir les candidats sans interférence. Une fois élus, ces candidats et candidates doivent jouir d'une plus grande marge de manœuvre lors des votes en chambre. Tout ça semble bien beau, mais en réalité, on ne s'attaque vraiment qu'à un problème abstrait. En fait, l'occasion d'œuvrer pour améliorer le concret a été enterrée au printemps dernier avec la crédibilité démocratique du gouvernement, dans une fausse conjointe. On ne choisit pas les candidats comme on choisit les chefs de parti. Ce ne sont pas des débats et des conventions à grand déploiement. Ce sont, dans la plupart des cas, des candidatures auxquelles personne ne s'oppose. Donc, C-586 cherche bel et bien à modifier la perception qu'a l'électorat, celle plutôt fausse que tout est décidé d'avance et que le parti est une roue immense qui passe sur le Canada à la veille d'une élection et qui écrase toute sa volonté propre. Mais ce n'est pas le cas. Sauf que, et c'est pour ça que j'appuie ce projet de loi, ça pourrait le devenir, et on peut le prévenir ce risque tout de suite. Il revigore un certain entrain partisan, il forcerait les partis à tenir des comptes plus serrés lors des nominations dans les circonscriptions. C-586 comporte aussi un autre élément très intéressant et plutôt révélateur de ce qui se passe dans les rangs conservateurs, d'où aucune information ne s'échappe jamais, sauf quand un député est écouté par l'atmosphère de trous noirs, c'est les largues. Le projet de loi veut réformer les aspects de ce qui s'appelle la culture de ligne de parti. Dans le préambule de ce projet de loi apparaît une phrase d'une très grande importance. Je la cite. « Attendu que la direction d'un parti politique doit garder la confiance de son groupe parlementaire. » Encore une fois, on est face à face avec un léger glissement sémantique. lors des congrès, les gens qui constituent la base partisane d'un parti politique peaufinent et affirment les résolutions qui deviennent la base idéologique de la formation à laquelle ils adhèrent. Le chef du parti, lui, dirige les élus avec sa propre vision stratégique des enjeux auxquels la base partisane accorde de l'importance. C'est elle ou lui qui orchestre la primauté de tous ses désirs, qui fait les calculs et qui prend tous les risques. Les députés doivent appuyer le chef et ses décisions, puisqu'avec lui, ils forment une molécule d'appui populaire. La ligne de parti, c'est l'accord entre le chef et les députés. C'est ce qu'offre le parti à l'électorat qui lui a octroyé sa confiance. L'électorat n'est pas partisan, lui. Les partis en chambre doivent respecter la diversité des opinions du public. Les chefs de parti détiennent la confiance de la base partisane. Celle-ci a l'occasion de confirmer ou d'infirmer cette confiance lors d'un vote durant les conventions nationales. Quand on se présente pour être candidat ou candidate lors d'une élection, on annonce appuyer un chef. La plateforme électorale est un compromis. Certains de ses aspects peuvent ne pas plaire, mais il prend la décision de se concentrer sur certains aspects clés. Les crises de conscience en bout de chemin, lorsqu'on savait pertinemment dans quel bateau on montait pour descendre le Danube, ce n'est pas une composante du déficit démocratique. Désolé, c'est simplement une réalité auquel il faut faire face. Certains autres éléments du projet de loi me causent un problème par rapport aux pratiques internes des partis. Par exemple, je comprends que l'inclusion d'une élection pour le président des caucus peut sembler une excellente idée pour un parti qui ne fait pas déjà ça présentement. Mais pour le NPD, élire un président de caucus une fois ou quatre ans serait un recul par rapport à notre pratique actuelle de tenir une élection à chaque année. En plus, notre parti fonctionne avec un système de parité homme-femme qui marche très bien. Évidemment, si ce projet de loi nous forçait à régresser sur ces fronts, j'aurais de la difficulté à l'appuyer. Mais le parrain du projet de loi nous a assuré que ces changements deviendraient des suggestions plutôt que des obligations. Donc maintenant que le député de Wellington Halton Hills a indiqué qu'il était prêt à changer en comité par des amendements certains des éléments de son projet de loi, je pense que la meilleure décision présentement est tout à fait de voter pour, d'envoyer ce projet de loi en comité, d'étudier les impacts et les effets de ces réformes. C'est pour ça, Monsieur le Président, que je vais appuyer ce projet de loi dans l'espoir qu'un peu de bon va réussir à en sortir. Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Resuming debate, the honourable member for Edmonton-Leduc.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. It's my pleasure today to rise to speak very proudly in favour of the Reform Act introduced by my friend and colleague, the Member of Parliament for Wellington Halton Hills. At the outset, I'd like to commend him for the substance of this bill and the substantive debate that he has caused both here in this House of Commons and across the country, as well as the manner and the process that he has followed in presenting his reforms. He presented a first version of this bill last year and sought meaningful input from members of Parliament, Canadians across the country. In fact, I can personally attest to the fact that he came to my constituency and engaged directly with many people in the riding. It was an excellent example of real citizen engagement. I want to thank him for that. After receiving all of this input, he proposed two different sets of amendments. One, he proposes Reform Act 2014, and the second, I believe, on September the 11th. And it's my understanding that the government, as well as members of the opposition, will be supporting the bill. He did make a real effort to hear constructive criticism of the bill. I know that there are people there who are supportive of this legislation who wish that he would have kept it in its original form. And I say to him that he has shown some courage and he has shown some real flexibility in trying to get a piece of legislation that can be supported by a majority of the members of this House and hopefully a majority of the members of the Senate as well. To just review the Reform Act itself, the Reform Act proposed three main reforms: restoring local control over party nominations, strengthening caucus as a decision-making body, and reinforcing the accountability of party leaders to their caucuses. The purpose of these reforms is to strengthen Canada's democratic institutions by restoring the role of elected members of Parliament in the House of Commons. The proposals in the Reform Act would reinforce the principle of responsible government, something that I will return to over and over again in this speech. It would make the executive more accountable to the legislature and ensure that party leaders maintain the confidence of their caucuses, something that has existed, in fact, since Parliament began. In fact, if one wants to review, especially on the Conservative side of the House, an excellent example of party leaders must maintaining the confidence of their caucus, one only has to go back to perhaps the greatest parliamentarian of all time, Winston Churchill, who became Prime Minister during World War II at a period in which someone else held a majority of the seats of the House of Commons. The Conservative government had a majority of the seats of the House of Commons. Churchill was, in fact, not party leader, but that change was made. And I think, for all of our sakes, it was a much better change. That's certainly a historical example, especially for Conservative parliamentarians. Responsible government, as we know, is the principle that the Executive Council, the Cabinet, is responsible and accountable to the Executive Legislative Assembly, the House of Commons, not the appointed governor. This was, in fact, a change that was made in Canadian history. Now, much of this debate is focused upon present-day situation or about the concentration of power that has occurred over the past 40 years. But I want to commend the member for Halton because he has, in fact, tried to say this is a fundamental realigning of Parliament, that one has to go beyond the present personalities and the present circumstances of today. We all have our present-day debates, but we need to think fundamentally of that relationship between the executive and the legislative. This is something that has perplexed, frankly, political thinkers since the advent of political activity and political organization, since people started distinguishing between the different roles that the executive or the legislative or those who dispense funds and those who raise funds ought to have. Now, why is it so important to restore the proper balance between the executive and the legislative? Why should we care about responsible government? Because in my view, democracy is the best form of government, to turn around one of Churchill's phrases. It's the best form of government. And in my view, parliamentary democracy is the best form of democracy. But in order to truly be a parliamentary democracy, it must both be representative and responsible. It must be representative in that the legislative branch, members of parliament, must be duly elected and accountable to their constituents. It must be responsible in that the executive branch, the cabinet, the government, must be accountable to those legislatures. It requires those two absolute functions. If one surveys the early histories of parliaments, as I've done recently, especially excellent works like J.R. Maddicott's The Origins of the English Parliament, I recommend it to everyone in this place and everyone across the country, one will actually see that the powers of the executive during those early parliaments, the king or queen, actually existed outside of parliament. And they were challenged at that time. Of course, parliament started as sort of a council of advisors, some from the moneyed property classes, some from the ecclesiastical classes. Even then, at that time, they started two important functions which we continue today, which is they started challenging the sovereign with respect to the raising of money, taxes, most often to fight wars, and with respect to the review of spending. So these two essential functions, which Parliament still fulfills today in terms of ways and means motions and estimates process, actually started centuries ago in these early parliaments. But at that time, the executive power actually resided outside of Parliament in the sense of it resided with the king or with the queen. What happened over time was that these executive powers moved, in effect, from the Crown to the advisors of the Crown, the Privy Councillors, as they're still called today, and then over time, especially to ministers of cabinet and the Prime Minister within the legislature. This was a very fundamental change that occurred over many, many, many years. Is this wrong? Now, some may perceive there's an actual problem with this, and in fact, the Americans, in my view, saw this as a problem and chose a different system. They opted for a different system and separated very formally the executive, the president and the administration, completely separate from the Congress, the Senate and the House of Representatives. It is very straightforward to ensure formal responsibility between the executive branch and the legislative branch. It is also simple to ensure that American citizens can have, in fact, more than one vote and can split their votes. They split the votes between a vote for the president, vote for the member of the Senate, or the member of the representatives. In Canada, as you know, members have one vote. They have a vote for their member of parliament at the federal level. But I do not see this as a problem, having the executive within the legislature. In fact, I think it's a benefit. I think it's one of the beauties of the parliamentary system is that it is organic. As Edmund Burke would say, the parliamentary system, one of its advantages is it is organic. It can respond to situations. It is, in fact, a benefit to have the executive residing within the legislative. But what needs to happen then is responsible government. You need to ensure, and all parliamentary democracies must ensure, with this real transfer through the history of executive power from the sovereign to the Privy Council, the Cabinet, the Prime Minister, the executive clearly resides within the legislature, but we have to have responsible government where the executive, which resides within the legislature, is responsible to the legislature. It's much more complicated than the American system. I think it's better than the American system, but we must ensure that responsible government applies. Now, in my time remaining, Mr. Speaker, I want to address some of the concerns that have been raised And it's very difficult to do so because some of the concerns were raised by people who have raised issues about political parties have raised concerns. I think members of all political parties have raised concerns about MPs possibly usurping some of the role of political partisans in terms of selecting or deselecting leaders. But this role of caucus in terms of being responsible, having responsibility for the leadership, has always been there throughout history. And my view is caucus members will respond in a very meaningful way to it. I was in a situation in my first term in Parliament where, in fact, we had a very destabilizing situation. It would have been helpful, in fact, to have a set of rules to guide us in terms of how to deal with that in a much quicker way. Secondly, I would just appeal to those who say that the bill has been amended too much and not enough has retained from the original bill to pass. I would appeal to them and say that the member from Halton Hills has introduced a piece of legislation, has tried to be as constructive as he can to get support from all political parties so it has near unanimous support to pass this House. I therefore ask all members of Parliament to support this important bill to redress the imbalance that has occurred over decades in this country where the powers of the executive have grown and the strength of the legislative branch unfortunately has diminished. We need to restore the proper balance between the executive and the legislative. A true parliamentary democracy requires representative institutions, but it also requires responsible government. We need to honour these fundamental traditions of our parliamentary democracy. Thank you very much for your time, Mr. Speaker.
Reprise du débat, l'honorable député d'Abitibi-Témiscamingue.
Merci beaucoup, Monsieur le Président. Je tiens d'abord à préciser que le projet de loi qui a été présenté par notre collègue de Wellington, Halton Hills, fait vraiment partie d'un débat qui est beaucoup plus large à l'heure actuelle, soit la démocratisation de notre système parlementaire, la réforme de nos institutions démocratiques, la valorisation du rôle de chacun des députés au sein de leur caucus. Et lorsqu'on aborde un sujet aussi important, je pense que c'est essentiel de faire preuve d'ouverture, d'être prêt à avoir une discussion ouverte, être prêt à entendre des idées qui viennent de part et autre et ne pas avoir, si on peut dire, une prétention à la vérité absolue et être capable d'admettre que lorsqu'on touche un sujet aussi complexe, c'est vraiment la discussion qui va faire qu'on va en sortir le plus gagnant. Et c'est pour ça que j'aimerais remercier mon collègue parce que dès le départ, quand il a présenté son projet de loi, il a été ouvert à la discussion. J'ai pu lui parler de mes inquiétudes, de mes craintes dans son projet de loi. Il en a tenu compte, il s'est ouvert, il s'est montré ouvert à amender son projet de loi, à le modifier justement en fonction de ses préoccupations-là. Et c'est avec une attitude comme celle-là qu'on peut arriver à réformer notre système démocratique. Et c'est absolument pas avec une attitude où est-ce qu'on présente des projets de loi qui visent des réformes démocratiques, où est-ce qu'on n'est pas prêt à accepter aucun amendement et où est-ce que, si on peut dire, les dés sont déjà joués avant même que le débat commence, qu'on peut arriver à changer notre système parlementaire. Donc, je voulais prendre le temps de le remercier pour ça. Il faut comprendre que le projet de loi va apporter des modifications quand même assez substantielles au niveau des processus d'investiture et aussi au niveau des processus visant l'admission ou la réadmission d'un membre au sein d'un caucus et ou du chef de parti. Et je voudrais tout d'abord prendre le temps de vraiment parler un peu de ce qui se fait au NPD pour que les gens puissent comprendre par la suite les inquiétudes que j'avais. Il faut comprendre que nos règlements internes exigent qu'on procède à un examen biannuel de la direction, donc du chef, et même si cette personne-là est un premier ministre, il doit se soumettre à cet examen-là. Et on veille également à ce que le processus d'investiture de nos candidats soit transparent. Donc, il faut comprendre aussi qu'on a des politiques d'action positive. Donc, au sein de nos candidatures, on a mis en place des moyens pour s'assurer qu'on ait idéalement 50 % de femmes qui soient candidates. On favorise aussi les candidatures des candidats des groupes LGBT, des personnes autochtones, des jeunes, des personnes souffrant d'un handicap. dans les processus d'investiture. Et c'était d'ailleurs une de mes premières craintes au niveau du projet de loi, c'est que ces politiques d'action positive qui ont été mises en place par les partis, donc ici on ne parle pas d'un chef de parti qui pousse un candidat pour pousser un ami ou une personne qu'il connaît, mais qui essaie de promouvoir la candidature de quelqu'un parce qu'elle fait partie justement d'un de ces groupes d'action positive, ne soit pas minée. Et dans les amendements que mon collègue a l'intention de présenter en comité, ça va, si on peut dire, ne pas miner les actions positives qui sont menées par les partis politiques pour augmenter la représentation des groupes qui sont sous-représentés. Donc, c'est évident que dans tout le projet de loi, advenant le cas qu'une fois en comité, les amendements que mon collègue va déposer pour améliorer son projet de loi, soit pas accepté, c'est sûr que le vote pour la suite va être différent. Mais si les amendements sont adoptés, ils ont répondu à mes craintes et je vais pouvoir continuer. Aussi, quand on parle du processus qui permet, si on peut dire, d'expulser un membre d'un groupe parlementaire ou de tenir un vote au niveau d'un chef de parti, je crois ici que c'est important de tenir compte du fait, et on l'a vu dans certaines législatures, que ce soit ici au Canada ou ailleurs, que quelquefois, on a la problématique où est-ce que les gens vont commettre des gestes qui ne sont pas nécessairement illégaux, mais qui ne sont pas nécessairement bien vus. Et à l'heure actuelle, par exemple, si c'est un membre du caucus, bien, la décision revient au chef de considérer si c'est assez grave, si c'est trop grave ou si c'est encore dans les limites de l'acceptable, à savoir si un membre demeure membre de son caucus parlementaire. Alors que je crois que c'est beaucoup plus approprié que cette décision-là revienne à l'entièreté des membres du caucus, à savoir, par exemple, si la personne peut rester ou pas, ou si elle peut être réadmise ou pas, selon ce qui s'est passé. Également, bien, ça peut être la même chose au niveau du chef. Bien sûr, il peut y avoir des gestes qui ont été posés qui ne sont pas nécessairement illégaux, mais qui ne sont pas nécessairement bien vus. Donc, les membres d'un caucus pourraient demander de tenir un vote à savoir si cette personne-là a encore la légitimité morale d'être le chef du groupe parlementaire. Et je crois que ça peut être approprié de se poser la question. Il y a également aussi la question au niveau du chef qui pourrait être, au niveau médical, une personne qui pourrait refuser de, si on peut dire, de renoncer à être chef, alors qu'il y a des problèmes médicaux qui affectent son jugement, que ce soit, par exemple, quelqu'un qui fait un abus de substance ou quelqu'un qui a malheureusement une maladie qui affecte ses capacités cognitives, son autocritique, son jugement, et qui ne se retire pas de lui-même, bien, au moins ça met un mécanisme où est-ce que les gens pourraient, les membres d'un caucus parlementaire pourraient décider qu'est-ce qu'il y en est pour la suite des choses, pour leur chef. Donc, je crois que ça peut être intéressant d'en discuter en comité et que dans certaines circonstances, somme toute exceptionnelles, ça pourrait être des mesures qui pourraient aider les groupes parlementaires à prendre une décision qui serait non seulement, qui ne serait pas basée sur, si on peut dire, l'arbitraire ou le jugement d'une ou quelques personnes à l'intérieur d'un groupe, mais par la majorité des membres d'un caucus parlementaire. Également, quand j'ai lu le projet de loi de mon collègue, j'ai eu une surprise parce que, bon, quelquefois, on est un peu naïf ou on ne cherche pas dans tous les règlements. Et comme au NPD, on a un président qui est élu à toutes les années. On tient une élection à chaque année. Et on a aussi une parité au niveau des genres. Donc, si le président est un homme, automatiquement, la vice-présidente va être une femme et vice-versa. Mais j'ai été surprise parce que j'ai appris que c'est pas la norme partout. Moi, dans ma naïveté, j'étais sûre que dans toutes les parties, le président de caucus était élu. Pour moi, c'était juste logique. Et ça, c'est... Donc, je remercie mon collègue. J'ai appris que malheureusement, il y a des partis qui auraient bien à apprendre du NPD. Je trouve ça un peu dommage. Mais j'espère aussi que, et je comprends qu'avec les ajustements, que, si on peut dire, l'élection du président de caucus une fois par législature serait non pas, si on peut dire, un règlement strict, mais plutôt la norme minimale à respecter, et que si on veut tenir une élection à chaque année, comme c'est le cas actuellement au NPD, on va pouvoir continuer à le faire. Mais, par exemple, ce que je crois qui est important ici de retenir, c'est que d'élire les présidents de comités de caucus sont extrêmement, c'est quelque chose qui est extrêmement intéressant. Les gens s'assurent non seulement d'avoir une personne qui est compétente, qui a les bonnes fonctions, mais s'assure aussi d'avoir quelqu'un qui va être capable de les écouter. Et si on veut garder une harmonie dans un caucus parlementaire, je pense que c'est essentiel d'être capable de choisir la bonne personne, qui a, oui, les capacités, les qualités cognitives, la connaissance au niveau du système parlementaire, mais qui a aussi les habiletés humaines qui leur permettent de juger adéquatement de la situation et d'être capable d'intervenir au travers des instances, soit du parti ou du groupe parlementaire, pour le bien-être de ses membres. Et d'élire le président de caucus, je crois que c'est une très bonne façon de le faire. Donc, j'aimerais remercier mon collègue une dernière fois pour l'ouverture qu'il a fait preuve lors de la discussion que j'ai pu avoir eu avec concernant les inquiétudes que j'avais. J'aimerais le remercier.
Resuming debate, there's 8 minutes remaining before the right of reply for the Honourable Parliamentary Secretary to the Minister of Foreign Affairs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it's a great honour for me to rise and speak on the Reform Act 2014 brought by my colleague here from Wellington, Halton and Guild. Mr. Speaker, my dear friend from Edmonton Ledoux gave a little history about governments and Westminster's type of government. I, of course, Mr. Speaker, have traveled all over the world and have seen numerous forms of governments around across the world, not also only the Americans, but then we have the French, we have the military regimes, and we have dictatorships, and we have all kind of other governments. But what is very clearly important, Mr. Speaker, is the form of democracy that we have elected here in Canada, the Westminster style of democracy, which has tested the time, the strength of time coming from UK, Mr. Speaker. Although I do have to say, in what I'm saying, it's regretful that our Senate is not an elected Senate out here. Having said that, the House of Commons indeed is an institution that, for all everybody says whatever they want to say, Mr. Speaker, is a very respected institution, giving good governance to Canada, from based on my own experience traveling around the world. Mr. Speaker, I have been a member of Parliament for close to 14 years, 17 years now. And through this process, I've gone through a tremendous amount of political functions that have taken place in this country, Mr. Speaker. I started as a Reform MP, and then Canadian Alliance, then as the old Progressive Conservative Party, and then the new Progressive Conservative Party. As I like to say, I never crossed the floor. The parties crossed on me, Mr. Speaker. But going through all this system over here, you learn one thing, Mr. Speaker, where is the basic situation? Sure, there are always ways and rooms to improve, but the main basic thing that I learned from all this thing here is that our process, Mr. Speaker, has checks and balances through not through legislation, as it has been, but through practice, Mr. Speaker, with this thing. And let me give an example of that, as my friend from Ledoux talked about the crisis we had during the Canadian Alliance. I do want to say, Mr. Speaker, I was through all of that, and I must say, give great credit of what happened over there was to Stockwell Day, who then realized that the caucus was not with him at that given time, took the right step, went back out there, back to seek the membership again from the leadership from the member. This is the kind of decisions, Mr. Speaker, that are in practice over there, which we have, Mr. Speaker, in part of us. But I do want to say, and I do want to commend my colleague here, trying to bring this and trying to kind of formalize it, Mr. Speaker. And where I had a very strong objection to his bill was the what I felt was that the membership's voice was being taken away by giving more power to the caucuses, to the Elections Canada and this thing. But to his great credit, Mr. Speaker, he heard all of us, our objections, and I want to commend him for bringing in the amendments that he did, which addresses many of the concerns we have had, Mr. Speaker, which I must say, you know, that gives back, in my opinion, the powers back to the membership, as, for example, his first step amendment by letting the parties decide who's going to be the person in charge. It does not matter, Mr. Speaker, who the person is in charge, whether it's the Prime Minister, whoever, but it is the membership that will decide, and that is part of his amendment. Mr. Speaker, I want to say thank you to the Minister of State for Democratic Reform, who worked throughout the summer with the members, with the others, in bringing in a lot of amendments that have now made us feel very, Mr. Speaker, that I feel that I am in a situation where a lot of positive things is now coming out of this bill. One or two of those positive steps that is, I'm quite comfortable with is the elections of the caucus chair, Mr. Speaker. I think a democratically elected caucus chair is an absolute good idea. And also the caucus should have the ability to bring in and bring out, admit or readmit people who have been removed from caucus, and it should be a caucus choice, which makes it a democratic institution, Mr. Speaker. So that is excellent. But I do still have some little problems over here, which he has, of course, addressed. Again, that comes to the issue of the leadership, which he said parties, caucuses can opt in and come and opt out. What I'm saying now, Mr. Speaker, is that it is a bill now that we can all debate, we can all talk about it. There are some positive aspects to it that we can move forward, and then as the bill goes to the committee, we can talk about other things where we have concerns. I will talk to him again, the little two concerns that I do have, and see how best we can bridge that grip, which will allow us, Mr. Speaker, at the end of the day, to make it a bill that is acceptable to all of us, which will strengthen the democracy in this country. So I want to give him a credit for bringing it forward. We are waiting for this. We will vote for the bill to go to the committee, and then at the committee we'll bring further. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Resuming debate. With his 5-minute right of reply, the Honourable Member for Wellington, Halton Hills.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Quand j'ai proposé la loi de 2014 instituant des réformes, j'avais dit que j'accueillerais avec intérêt les commentaires et les amendements. Depuis son dépôt, la loi de 2014 instituant des réformes a suscité beaucoup d'intérêt et de discussion. Ces derniers mois, j'ai reçu les recommandations, les commentaires de collègues de deux côtés de cette chambre, de la chambre et des Canadiens de partout du pays. So I want to thank all members of this House that have contributed to this debate, in particular the member for Edmonton-Leduc for seconding the bill, many members of my caucus, members from Mississauga, from Bruce Gray-Owen Sound, members from Toronto Danforth and from Burnaby Douglas, the other members of the New Democratic Caucus who have been up today to debate this bill, the member from Laurier-Cartierville and Saint-Laurent-Cartierville, and also the member for Saanich Gulf Islands, who has been a big supporter of this initiative all along, as well as the Minister for Democratic Reform. Thank you to all who voiced concerns and constructive criticisms about the original bill. Mr. Speaker, change is never easy. And the changes proposed last week and the changes incorporated into the bill introduced last spring reflect the input that was received. I want to take this opportunity, Mr. Speaker, to respond directly to one concern, and that is the general concern about imposing on parties, whether they be party caucuses or registered political parties, mandatory rules about how they operate, whether that concerns the election of party candidates or it concerns the rules regarding the review and removal of the party leader or the election of a caucus chair or the expulsion of a caucus member. I believe that the changes announced last week directly address those concerns. These changes, which I hope the Standing Committee on Procedure and House Affairs will adopt, leave it to the parties, whether it be party members at a national convention or to members of a party caucus, to decide on how to implement these particular changes. Any rules would have to be voted on, either by party members on the floor of a national convention or by caucus members within a caucus. And regardless of the outcome, it would be a recorded vote, so that members of parliament can be held accountable not just to their constituents, but also to party members as to why they voted the way they did. I think it's also important to note that this bill will not affect in any way, shape or form how parties outside the House, how registered political parties review the leader, or how those parties elect the leader in the event they have a leadership race. All the bill does is clarify the rules concerning the review and removal of the party leader by caucus, and in the event that the party leader is removed, or in the event that the party leader becomes incapacitated, suddenly dies or resigns, provides for the clarity in rules on the election of the interim leader. Mr. Speaker, I think it's important to point out that party caucuses are not private organizations, because if they are private organizations, then we have semi-privatized the election and removal in part of premiers and prime ministers. It's important to point out to colleagues that in the last 9 months, two premiers have been removed from office as a result of caucus action, Premier Dunderdale in Newfoundland and Labrador and Premier Redford in Alberta. It's also important to point out that party caucuses in the last 9 months at the provincial level have elected four new interim leaders during that time. So I think there's a greater need for clarity and transparency about how these changes take place at the federal level and why we need to pass the bill. Now, Mr. Speaker, many wanted to see this bill pass in its original form. I understand. However, in this case, we need to acknowledge that perfection is the enemy of the good. The bill in its original form would never have passed Parliament. The bill in front of us today is very good and has a good chance of passing and becoming law. And I reserve the right, Mr. Speaker, to not move this bill at third reading if the committee makes changes that are unacceptable. In closing, Mr. Speaker, I urge members of this House to adopt this bill next week. And more importantly, Mr. Speaker, I urge members of the Procedure and House Affairs Committee to deal with this bill as expeditiously as possible. Time is short. There are mere few months before the dissolution of Parliament and the onset of the general election. We cannot allow this bill to die in the order paper. Canadians are watching.
This concludes the debate. Accordingly, the question is as follows. Mr. Chong, seconded by Mr. Harris, Caribou, Prince George, move that Bill C-586, an Act to Amend the Canada Elections Act and the Parliament of Canada Act, Candidacy and Caucus Reforms, be now read a second time and referred to the Standing Committee on Procedure and House Affairs. Is it the pleasure of the House to adopt the motion?
No.
All those in favour will please say yea.
Yea.
All those opposed will please say nay.
Nay.
In my opinion, the yeas have it. Pursuant to Standing Order 93, the division stands deferred until Wednesday, September 24, 2014, immediately before the time provided for private members' business.